Father, thank you for the opportunity to gather again this evening. I ask that you would bless this time, give us understanding into the scripture tonight, help us to know more of you and to be put on fire by your word, to be more obedient to you and to live for your glory. Help me to faithfully preach your word this evening, and it's in your name I pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. By way of introduction, I want to draw out and discuss one of the main themes that we're going to see in our passage here tonight. It's the concept of being exiles, of being sojourners in the world. Some have taken this particular concept and have twisted it in a couple of different ways. First, you have those who believe that we are exiles, and so we should have nothing whatsoever to do with the world at all. We should have nothing to do with the culture, nothing to do with the society around us. The problem with that position is that it's not the way that Christ or the early church lived. You can't be salt and light if you're not willing to shine the light into the darkness or act as a preservative somewhere. Nor can you engage unbelievers with the gospel if you're never encountering them. So the particular idea that we should simply isolate ourselves from society at large isn't biblical. Others take an approach where they say that we should go befriend the world, that we should take up close relationships with unbelievers, that we should seek to learn from them in terms of our theology and so forth. That is another approach. Now, being friends with unbelievers, it can be done rightly and it can be done wrongly. I am friends with unbelievers myself, but I don't seek spiritual guidance. I don't seek spiritual wisdom from them. They don't have guidance grounded in the scripture to be able to give in that sense at all. So long as we keep that fact in mind, we can be friends with unbelievers. We can interact with them regularly even. It's one thing to be friends with an unbeliever because you enjoy the same hobby. It's quite another to go to them for advice about how to raise your children. Those around us will impact us, and so we have to be wise and discerning at all times. I think you get the point there in terms of the distinction. What the Bible commands is that we would not be friends with the world, that we would be separate from the world in the sense of not buying into its false beliefs, in the sense of not participating in the sins of the world. Talk with unbelievers, show them kindness and compassion, take them to lunch, share the gospel with them, that they might be changed and become followers of Christ. We're not supposed to be exiled in the sense of never having contact with them. Instead, we're supposed to not compromise with their beliefs and their sins. Let's see what Peter says around this point here this evening, and let's stay out of the two ditches on both sides of the world and take the biblical path. Read 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 11 through 12 here with me. Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. In this particular passage, we have three primary points that we need to examine. First, in the opening portion of verse 11, we see the identity of the believers, that Peter calls them sojourners and exiles. We've seen this theme develop in a couple of different places over the letter of 1 Peter. As we saw in verse 9, we are Christ's possession, which makes us foreigners to the lost world. Back in the very first verse of this letter, Peter called the saints elect exiles. Then in verse 17 of chapter 1, he mentioned their exile. This is an important point for Christians to remember at all times, but how much more during times of persecution, during times of suffering? It can be very tempting to compromise with the world during such instances. We need to look at the example of faithful believers like Daniel and like Joseph, who endured suffering well for the glory of God. We can struggle with a wide variety of temptations to somehow partake of the sins of the world instead of living for Christ. That's certainly true even outside of persecution. But we can think of someone like John Bunyan in this regard, who faithfully understood this calling to be a stranger and an exile during a time of suffering. John Bunyan was one of the great Baptist preachers in church history. He sat in a jail cell in 1661, and he would be imprisoned until 1672. He was allowed to write occasionally. He was allowed to preach at illegal gatherings. He wrote one of the most famous books ever in the English language, Pilgrim's Progress. If you haven't read it, you should order the book immediately. You should wait till I finish the sermon, but you should order it very quickly. Bunyan worked from prison to try to support his family, but they were largely supported through the generosity of other individuals because of his imprisonment. All Bunyan had to do to go free was to simply say that he would not preach. He had a blind daughter, as well as many other children. His first wife had died, but he had married again, so clearly this is a man who was well acquainted with tragedy. Don't you think it would have been tempting for him to just give in, especially having a blind child who needs special help? Don't you think that would have been tempting for him? How would you and I respond in such a situation? Do you compromise, or do you stand strong in that instance? Well, Bunyan responded by telling the authorities that he had rather stay in jail until the moss grew on his eyelids than to disobey the explicit command and calling upon his life that Christ had given to him. Bunyan understood what it was like to be a stranger, to be an exile to the world. The temptation is to compromise. That is why we must view ourselves as exiles, as Peter commands us here. It's not that we're going off into a monastery, being completely separate, never participating in society. No, Peter's point here is to understand that we are to live as those who are members of the kingdom of Christ. In other words, we're redeemed by Christ. So we seek to serve him, to live in this world as his ambassadors. We stand against the ways, the sinful ways of the world, and we live in submission to our Lord. Understanding the necessity to be in exile is critical for us now. It is vital because you're going to have pressures placed upon you. We all will. By those seeking to persecute you, yes, but not just from that, also from lost individuals. Simply from the pressures of living in a fallen world as a Christian. Your lost friends, your lost family members do not understand your commitment to Christ. They don't understand your commitment to the Scripture. They don't get biblical Christianity because they're not Christians. And so even the pressure to back down from the standard of the Word of God, simply in that sense from your lost friends and family members, it is real for the believer. But the scriptural teaching here is for us to view that as foreign, to view that as the sinful ways of this world from a foreign master, because they are, the lost individuals are serving their master, Satan, and their master, the ways of their own flesh. We are serving Christ. We are not serving the devil. We are not serving the flesh. We are not serving the world. We are serving the Lord who purchased us with his own blood, which means that we must press in here, that we must continue on the path laid for us by Christ. If you want to see someone who is the example of a sojourner in exile, go read the Gospels and look at the example of Christ. Does being an exile mean that he didn't care anything about this world? Absolutely not. He created the world. He healed individuals during his earthly ministry. He preached the good news of the kingdom to lost sinners. He labored as a carpenter for many years before ever entering into the ministry. He looked upon others with compassion and had a real love for them. Yet we know that as it pertains to the sins of the world, the false beliefs of the world, Christ was very much an exile, for he himself never committed sin. And he never bought into the lies of the world. He did not bow before Satan. He did not worship the devil when he was tempted to in the wilderness. He did not give in to the sinners of the world. And this is the pattern that we must follow. It is hard to live a holy life in the midst of a hostile world, but that is the biblical calling. It is the call of biblical Christianity, and it is the power of Christ, the grace of Christ that gives us the strength to do so. And this is what Peter tells us about our identity in the Lord. We are his, and so we are sojourners and exiles for the glory of Christ. But he gives us even more information in this area. At the end of verse 11, he urges us to be sojourners and exiles, to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. And here's our second point. We see the calling of exiles. Peter very simply says, don't give in to your flesh. It's interesting that he doesn't give a list of do's and don'ts at this point. It's just a very straightforward statement. It's very easy to understand, but it's often very difficult to implement. It is hard to battle against the sins of the flesh. There is a literal war here in the life of the believer. That Peter is talking about these fleshly desires waging war against the soul. The flesh wants you to speak harshly to a loved one. The flesh wants you to compromise in the face of adversity. The flesh wants you to stray from biblical truth and to go into doctrinal heresy. It is your flesh that wants you to practice that which is contrary to the biblical commandments. Not only does your flesh want you to commit sin, it actually wants you to not do that which God has commanded. It is our flesh which causes us to desire not to proclaim the truth. Jonah yielding to the flesh is why he ran from his responsibility to proclaim the truth to the people of Nineveh. Now, that's a perfect example of how not to fight your flesh. Instead of being obedient, Jonah ran away. But by the grace of God, we win battles against the flesh. We put to death our sin progressively, and we advance in the faith. But this takes a proper view of sanctification. It means that we must rightly understand that the battle of the Christian life is an entirety. That this is something that's not going to be finished until we go home to glory to be with the Lord. It's something that we do in our young days. It's something that we do in our middle-aged days. And it is something that we must press into in our older days. And that's an important aspect of sanctification to remember. That you and I will never reach a point in our lives where we do not have to deal with the temptations of the flesh. That where we do not have to fight to be completely devoted to the Lord. But if we're going to be salt and light in this world, we must be pure in terms of our conduct. We must be wholly devoted to the Lord. We must live according to His word, completely trusting in Him. And by the way, this is not just true of us individually. It is true of the local church together, the local bride of Christ. What is done must not be according to the flesh. It must be governed by the word of God. Churches veer from this concept all of the time. They give into the ways of the flesh and the ways of the world and in terms of how they conduct themselves. I'm sure that we've all seen congregations that put on the secular light show and they cater their message to lost individuals and they preach a false gospel. And the whole concept is simply built upon entertaining lost sinners. I'll never forget the time that I had a friend in Little Rock invite me to go to church with him and his family. We were staying in the town for a few days. And so they asked us to go to church, and so we met them at this place, and it was definitely a mega church, at least by Little Rock standards. I mean, this isn't Houston or Dallas or something like that. But it was Father's Day, and so we go into the congregation in the midst, and the first thing that we see is that a bunch of individuals come onto the stage and they start singing Sharp Dressed Man by ZZ Top. And if you're not familiar with the song, let's just say that it's a really, really bad idea. And let's leave it at that. But what it is this is a desire by a church to use worldly means to attract worldly individuals. It's giving into the desires of the flesh. That is all it is, and we must not fall prey to that sort of a thing. And yet the desires of the flesh can creep in more subtle ways. Just because the local church isn't singing ZZ Top on the stage doesn't mean the desires of the flesh haven't crept in. Like I said earlier, it's not just the sins that we commit against God. It's also us omitting what God has commanded of us. We can give into the flesh by that way as well. And so the question is, do we as Christians in the local church, do we participate in evangelism? Are we involved in actively encouraging and edifying one another? Are we seeking the good of the other believers in the local church? Are we practicing all of the commands found in the scripture for the church? These are things that we all must individually see. Are we following Christ in this way individually? Are we following Christ in this way together as a local church? Our flesh will wage war against these aspects also. The fastest growing church that I know of is a congregation in Conway, which I've talked about before. Needless to say, they don't sing Sharp Dressed Man or anything like that. If you go to a service there, you'll see that it's pretty straightforward. They sing 6 or 8 songs. They have quite a few passages of scripture that they read. They have about a 45-minute sermon, roughly. The whole service lasts in a ballpark of about 1.5 hours, give or take a little bit more. The church is eager to gather for fellowship. There's no gimmicks. There's no games. The congregation is staying together regardless of age the entire time. The music is theologically rich, comprised of old hymns and new hymns that are very deep, biblically speaking. The sermon is a walk through a text, going verse by verse through books of the Bible. The congregation delights in worship together. The church grew organically over many, many years just because the members are involved. And the entire thing centers around Christ. There's no fleshly reason to go to church there. And that's exactly the point. That they've not governed their lives, they've not governed their services, their local church, around the desires of the flesh, but around the commands of the Word of God. And a congregation like that will be blessed by Christ. May or may not reach 1,000 people or 500 people or whatever the number may be, but they will be blessed in terms of the enrichment to their own souls. That they will grow in their walk with Christ. That they will grow in their love for one another. Why? Because Christ honors faithfulness in whatever way he deems fit to bestow honor upon it for the glory of his name. The power of the word, the power is in the word of God. And so we must not compromise, but delight in it. And so this passage here has immense applications, and it is incredibly applicable for us to consider. Now, are there any ways that we are giving into the flesh instead of fighting it? Are there any ways where we need to pursue the commands of Christ more? What actions do we need to take to be more obedient to the Lord? These are soul-searching questions that each one of us must consider as prompted by this passage. Each one of us will have different strengths. Each one of us will have different weaknesses. And that is why we need the local church, so that we can come together and rub off on one another and strengthen one another where the other is weak, so that we can encourage each other in the Word. It is a war to keep the purity of our own lives according to the Scripture, and it is a war to keep the purity of the church in terms of faithfulness to the Word of God. In verse 12, we find our third point here. We see the goal of the exile. Read the verse again with me, verse 12. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. Now, I think there's a very intriguing parallel between this verse and verse 9 of this chapter. In verse 9, we had seen about the truths of how Christ has changed us, about who we are in Christ this morning. And we saw that on the basis of that reality, we are called to go out and to proclaim his truth, to preach his gospel. There's a clear emphasis upon the fact that we are verbally to declare the great truths of our Lord. And here in verse 12, we see Peter talking about how we are to conduct ourselves amongst those who are unbelievers. Many stray into the ditch of saying that our proclamation of the truth does not matter, that actually verbally speaking the truth is irrelevant. They say that it's only our lives that matter, living a faithful life, because they believe that actions speak louder than words. First of all, the explicit command by Christ is to verbally declare the word. And so if you're not doing that, then you're not living a faithful life according to the Bible. And secondly, saying that we shouldn't speak the truth would be like a husband saying that he should never tell his wife that he loves her because he demonstrates it by his actions. How well do you think that's going to go over? Not well. Because our actions serve the purpose of demonstrating the truthfulness of our words. Because a husband loves his wife, he will act lovingly towards her, but also talk lovingly towards her. And so also because we love Christ, we will proclaim his gospel. And the way that we live adorns the reality of what we say. The truths that we proclaim, we actually live them out. And unbelievers take note of that. Whenever they see a person not only proclaiming the truth, but living the truth, they take note of that fact. Now, did you notice what Peter said that the unbelievers were doing in this verse? He said that the Gentiles were speaking against the Christians as evildoers. Despite the fact that the church was holy in its conduct, that they were living for the glory of Christ, that the gospel was spreading like a wildfire, the church slandered them for committing evil acts, for committing wickedness. They accused them of being atheists. The unbelievers of Rome, they levied the assault against the church that they were atheists because they didn't worship the Roman gods, because they didn't bow before the emperor. The early church was also known amongst the pagans as cannibals. The early church said that they ate the body and they drank the blood. Of course, they were talking about metaphors for the cup and the bread. Another charge against them was that of troublemaking, that of advocating unlawful customs and so forth. Neither the Roman pagans nor the Jewish leaders had a heart full of love for the Christians. And we see the same in our own day. The biblical Christians are called by many names in our culture. We often are labeled as those who are holding to a hateful, old school, backwards religion. And we are viewed as hateful ourselves. And that is exactly what the early church experienced as well. And what Peter wants us to be sure of is that we act honorably before the lost, so that not only they see the proclamation, they hear the proclamation of the gospel, but they see the purity of our lives. And so if someone knew everything about you, would they see a repentant Christian seeking to live for the glory of Christ, or would they see a hypocrite acting in a fake manner? Peter is not asking for us to be nice so that the world will like us. He is calling upon us to have morally honorable conduct, to be noble, to be excellent in our character before others, that character would demonstrate itself to others. It's not that we're focused on the lost world, trying to act in a way that is morally right for their sake. It's that we have been so transformed by the Lord that we're seeking to put to death the sin that we see, and that fact evidences itself to anyone who knows us. Our eye is not on the world, our eye is on the glory of God Himself. And this is so that when they rail against us, the unbeliever is prompted to remember the purity of the life of the believer. He is prompted to remember the proclamation of the gospel by that believer. And God often will use that to bring them to faith and repentance in Himself. Now, that's what it means. Look at the end of the verse. It says, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on a day of visitation. When these lost sinners are given salvation by Christ, they will remember these good deeds and the ones that they have seen past believers undertake. Often Christ will use this in the process of drawing someone to Himself. I can only imagine the thoughts about Stephen, the thoughts about others who he had killed that the Apostle Paul must have had after he came to faith in Christ. We can only begin to speculate as to the impact that had on the life of Paul and other believers who had targeted the early Christians and then come to faith. You see, so many believers today, they have this idea that being a good witness to the world, it means that we just go along with them with a smile on our face and do whatever they want. Stephen understood the reality that being a good witness means that when you are called, you die. You die a martyr's death in a way that is honoring to Christ. That's quite a different perspective. That's quite a biblical perspective. And so what we must do as believers is continue to pursue the Lord, to fight against the flesh, to fight against the sins that remain in our life, and to conform ourselves to biblical character. We must not only proclaim the truth, we must live it every day. That is what Peter is calling us to in these verses. It is a high calling, but the Lord gives us His own Spirit dwelling within us to empower us to obey these commands. And I pray that we will be a faithful witness, knowing that it is God who is watching us. Let's end this time in a word of prayer together. Father, thank You for the opportunity to go through this passage. I ask that You would help us not only to be faithful to proclaim Your truth, but to live according to it in the entirety of our lives. that we know more about you, Lord Jesus, that we would put to death the sins of the flesh, that you would open our eyes to be able to see those clearly, that you would strengthen us according to your Spirit to actively pursue sanctification in you, and that you would cause that to be a testimony to the lost world, that they would see, hear the proclamation of the gospel, that they would see the purity of your church, and that you would use that to draw them to faith and repentance in yourself, Lord. Help us to glorify you over this next week, and it's in your name I pray, Lord Jesus. Amen.